Star Trek 57, M23, take two.
It's got Star Trek, Episode 51. Discovery, Season 3, Episode 5, Die Trying.
Admiral, are you familiar with Earth's Renaissance painter, Giotto?
Where are you going with this?
The period before the Renaissance was referred to as the Dark Ages, a frightening time. Humanity was under siege from wars and plagues and was losing its way. Giotto helped spark the Renaissance when, with his art, he helped create the three-point perspective.
He saw depth.
He saw entirety, and he gave what he saw to the world. It made a difference. For the first time in a long time, humans looked up. Discovery is a servant of the Federation. But I believe that our unique perspective from a revered time may
help us to look up.
Yes, sir.
This is the point in the show where we usually welcome people to the podcast and get them all riled up and excited.
Fruity Pebbles.
I will say that I had an odd experience this week related to the podcast, where I was just sitting there and then God spoke to me.
No way.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know, because I'm not generally speaking a believer in God.
Yeah, you wouldn't buy into that shit. You'd be like, what could have scientifically spoken to me like that?
I'm kind of turned on by like how awesome that is. Yeah, I'm sure you were meaning to mock me, but I was like, wow, look at that. Yeah. That guy is fucking hot.
Yeah.
Talking about science, pointing his finger up in the air.
Yeah, I was kind of into it as I was saying it too.
So yeah, all right. Maybe it was a hallucination. You can interpret it however you like. But what they said was, what this creature that I communed with said was,
you've been drinking cough syrup?
No,
just
not
making sure.
Not lately. They suggested that we ask for ratings, reviews, likes, and subscribes at the beginning of the show, instead of at the end, which we don't even usually do at the end because we forget.
Well,
we find it obnoxious.
Well, why at the beginning?
In case people don't hang out to the end.
Because people might be listening and they might be like, yeah, whoa, these guys are rad.
Well, what if they're like, oh man, they're selling out already. Well, I'm going to turn this off.
That was a risk I was willing to take because, again, I had this powerful hallucination and or communion with some sort of higher being that just suggested that, I don't know that it was God. Maybe it was somebody from God's marketing department who was just passing along some.
Was it a higher being or were you being higher?
A fair point. There are a few permutations to how this works. But anyway, Star Trek.
Star Trek.
Star Trek Discovery.
Star Trek.
Okay, so the components are, this is the It's Got Star Trek podcast. It is the 51st episode of the It's Got Star Trek podcast. Mm-hmm. On the 51st episode of the It's Got Star Trek podcast, we are going to be discussing the 5th episode of Star Trek Discovery's 3rd season. And the title of that episode is...
Die Trying. You know, the 51st episode is actually more of a milestone than the 50th episode, because the 50th episode might as well be the 49th. It's not the new generation of episodes. The 51st episode is the newest generation.
Yeah, and it's one more.
Like 2001 and is the actual new millennium.
It's one more.
I see what you're saying.
It's also one more.
It's just one more. Yeah. It's one more into the future.
But it's like, that's the actual beginning. Millennium didn't begin at 2000. It began at 2001.
Yes.
It's the beginning of what, like everything after 50?
I don't know. It's just some way that time worked. I was bullshitting. I think 50th was the real, because we don't work by time. Yes, so Die Trying.
Star Trek. We're talking about Star Trek. All right. And it was spoiler alert, it was a really great episode.
I've
in some ways been enjoying each episode more than the previous one, which is kind of cool.
There was a lot to take in that first half of the show. I mean, there was a lot going on all over the place, but in the first half, it was just like,
a lot of stuff to just kind of miss.
Oh my God. Oh, there's that. And
when
there's that
stuff
too.
All blinks by.
Yeah, because they keep seeing all this new shit, and everyone's all like, oh,
yeah,
it never stops.
Right.
And it's kind of like awesome.
It is. It is very cool. And but even though they're seeing all this awesome stuff, the episode starts with a very classic Star Trek style with a captain's log supplemental.
Yeah, I was actually made a notice. I noted that. I don't know if I've heard many supplementals in Discovery, and was always wondered like what. How do they decide whether it's a supplemental or not? I don't know.
You know, there's a good question. I think my headcanon has always been that that's when they're kind of just, you know, they've already done their main captain's log talking about the mission or whatever, and then they're just kind of adding a little of their own flavor.
And they
like their own notes, kind
of. They never specified what their schedule of normal notes are.
Captain Riker and his supplemental log would just be, you know, trying out some trombone riffs.
Yeah.
Sort of awesome. Tooling around in a trombone.
Because normally the log is like we went this way for like this long, and then like we turned and we went this way, and like at this time of day we had lunch, and like it's just that kind of stuff. Like,
yeah,
we stopped here, we stopped there.
Yeah, that sounds like that's supplemental ones are probably more interesting because you really have a reason to say something. Yeah, so that's the deal with supplemental logs. Yeah.
And they, you know, they've skipped forward a little bit. They've already made contact with the Federation. They've got the coordinates from Adira.
Yeah, they jumped right to, they got the coordinates. They didn't mess around in between, like, trying to get to the coordinates. Mm-hmm. They had it. They got there. They moved on.
They got there. So,
which I'm glad for, because I was hoping last week that it wouldn't be some kind of, like, not that it would have been, like, Picard, like, it took him a while to get there. Mm-hmm. And that's not bad. It worked in Picard's favor.
Because it was part of the journey.
Yeah, exactly. Part of the journey.
The journey.
Right.
Journey is part of Frodo. Frodo. Frodo Baggins.
Bilbo. Bilbo. It's easier to do if you do Bilbo.
Bilbo. Bilbo. Bilbo. Bilbo.
But, yeah, Bilbo. I wanted them to move it on. Move it on home.
Move it on over.
What is it? What is it?
Because they got the spore drive, so they can just jump right there.
What's the episode of DS9? Move it on. Move it along.
Move along home.
I wanted him to move along home.
I love that episode.
Oh my god!
So hated.
You love it more and more every time you think about it.
Every time. I mean, granted, maybe when we go back and watch it, I'll be like, nah.
So what the problem with you saying that is that people are going to think when you say like Darmok and Jalad that you will actually you're being silly about that episode too.
No, because I do. Yeah, that's a great episode.
Yeah, I know, but some people think it's just like the dumbest episode.
So move along home, suffer. Like we're sidetrack. This is an episode of Side Treks with Move Along Home.
At least it's about Star Trek.
Side Trek. It's a new feature on the It's Got Star Trek podcast.
It's not a new feature.
Side Treks, where we talk about a different Star Trek. But Move Along Home, I'm not going to defend it in terms of being a great episode. It's charming. It's awkward. It has it's as if it was a TOS script that they just decided to do in the early 90s. I like it better. I would rather watch that, despite its flaws, than many other episodes of Star Trek, which I might find like boring.
And I think some people don't like Darmok and Jalad in the same way that they don't like Move Along Home.
Yeah, they might. Yeah. Or whatever, to each their own, right? Yeah. You know, we're not going to dictate what you like or do not like. But I am going to get giddy every time Move Along Home is mentioned.
Fair enough.
All right, let's warp back to the main topic. Good sound effect.
Thanks.
Star Trek Discovery.
So Federation and Starfleet headquarters are separate entities that must now abide together, is what Saru said.
Yeah.
So I was never fully aware the locations of each prior. So I guess the Federation of Planets that's just a Federation of Planets. It just kind of lives everywhere.
As much as I like this episode, I do think that there are a few Starfleet bits of dialogue that are a little weird or confusing.
Right, Starfleet
and this
was
is one of them.
Yeah, Starfleet was in San Francisco.
I thought they were both on Earth.
Yeah, Starfleet was headquartered in San Francisco, and I believe the Federation presidency, I think he was in Paris hanging out.
Okay.
I could be wrong about that, but I have a vague recollection somehow that they were based there. Anyway, it doesn't diminish the enjoyment of the episode for me, but and we'll point out a couple other examples along the way where there's just a couple lines here that sort of didn't make sense, but no biggie, because I think, you know, by and large, they got to where they needed to be. And, you know, when we're starting with this episode, at first it's like, okay, the Federation's hidden in some magic cloud. That's not that interesting, but the way they portrayed it, I thought was kind of cool.
Yeah.
In that it mimicked flying into space dock in a way. And then there were all sorts of little goodies. Did you catch any of the little goodies or cheat and read about them on the internet like I did?
A little of both, yeah.
Yeah, so...
Because there's one that I would never have caught.
There's one I think that you're probably referring to that I
you guys,
would have caught.
You don't need to be so coy.
Well, I was just going to say...
About the Nog?
Yeah, that's right.
Because I saw a picture in an article, and it was like, well, I never would have got that. Like, that was... Here's a snapshot in case you missed it. And I was like,
honoring the late Aaron Eisenberg, Nog on Deep Space Nine.
Yeah.
Who recently passed away, unfortunately, just late last year.
And his character had a nice arc to it.
Very nice arc.
Yes.
But we're not, that's not a short trek. I mean, that's not a side trek. That's not
a long trek.
And there was Voyager.
Yeah, there was
Voyager J.
Voyager J.
And there was a Constitution.
There was some kind of new
now
Constitution.
Sleep 1 to 2,000 people. The only things that I noticed weren't necessarily little goodies. They were just kind of cool things. For example, there were all these. I didn't even notice it the first time until the last shot of the episode, where I saw, of course, all the big things going on. But then there was all these little tiny ships flying, these little light things flying everywhere. There was a whole shitload of traffic going on. I didn't notice it at first. And then at the other thing I didn't notice that didn't really, I noticed but didn't strike me until a second viewing was that centerpiece of the whole place that they were all going towards. Mm-hmm. It was this bright fucking light. Like, is that, that's where they ended up in the episode, right? When they, that center brightness tube. That,
I think so.
That
it symbolizes they're all going to die and they're going to go to heaven.
Yeah, you know, I don't know about that. But, you know, was it are you being serious or...
Yes, when God talked to me, he said that the ending of Star Trek Discovery is they all die and go to heaven.
That would be...
And they meet the real God instead of the fake alien God that Kirk meets in Star Trek V.
And then a bunch of them, all the aliens would go to hell for being sinners.
Yes, that's exactly what happens, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah,
we've been promised.
No, it's a Catholic God, and the Catholics have already been, you know, more power to them. They said that aliens could be Catholics, too.
All right. Well, I didn't know why that center thing was so bright, and I didn't know why everyone was heading to it, and I don't know. And I guess that was the thing they went to in the beginning.
And generating the distortion field, and then they said all the ships were helping power it.
It must be so hard to go into that, because it hurts your eyes looking at that thing, you know? I imagine it would.
Yeah.
And it's so...
You have to avert your eyes.
You have to. Yeah. Like the Ark of the Covenant, or whatever it's called.
It's exactly... That's like what God. This symbolizes the Ark of the Covenant.
Yeah.
But not the real one. It symbolizes the one from the Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Right. So... I really like what they're doing.
Their faces got melted.
I really like what they're doing with this future Star Trek thing, which I think we talked about before, how some people, when they're thinking about when this new Star Trek was coming out, before the first season, people were, you know, wondering if it was going to be way in the future. And I like how that's, I really like how that's panning out. And it's kind of a neat sort of backdrop of, you know, you got someone from the TOS era sort of in the future. It's interesting that they went with the whole white, sterile kind of vibe for the insides of everything. Everything is just, they went for that classic.
Everything's pretty sterile. Yeah.
So, I don't know. It's fine. It's just not, it's every, why is everything so just like monochromatic? You know what I mean?
It's all, what was it, programmable matter?
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like the bridge they're walking on and the chairs are all like floating in the sky.
Yeah. Like, well, at the end when they're walking along the floor gets created as they're walking it. They're on a they're on the second story.
You stole that idea from Harry Potter.
So that might be confusing and troubling or problematic somehow for everyone involved. Because you're walking there, you're just like, oh. But if you're below there, if you're below, you're thinking, ah, look at all this ceiling space I have. I've got all this ceiling space.
Since like the 2750s or something.
I've got high ceilings. I've got tall ceilings. Oh no, someone's in here. One fucking person is in here, and now I don't have tall fucking ceilings anymore. And so you gotta adjust the depth to like, okay, some asshole is ruining my whole vision. What if there's like 30 people down there, and one asshole is up there ruining it for everyone?
Who's that guy up there?
He's like causing this floor.
It's that guy. Get him.
You sound like a real estate agent who's had enough.
He's
just had it up to here.
It's like, I can't make a sale.
We had a high ceiling and now we don't.
Yeah, that is a real estate realtor's nightmare. You
I
know?
Bet it sounds like.
Yeah,
it.
But then if you have the automatic bridge, you can walk across the bridge and be like, I'm walking here. And you kind of look down and laugh at your friends. Your friends look at you slightly aggravated because you do this joke constantly.
They shake their
like, you don't even need to be up there, Joe. You don't need to be up there. You're not on duty up there. You're on duty down here. I just want to say your stupid joke,
you're
Joe.
You're doing that bit you do.
I'll put you on duty.
Charlie? Ham Jam?
Charlie Vance.
Hey, what's this? What movie is this from? Charlie. Charlie. Charlie.
The movie you just made up?
It's All Dogs Go to Heaven.
I didn't see that movie.
Charlie.
That movie, I have seen that movie. That movie's depressing.
Sounds depressing.
It is depressing.
Never watched it.
Some dark shit, man.
I never saw that Malcolm in the Middle dog movie or whatever. My dog Frankie Muniz or whatever. where Frankie.
I'm not even going to think about that.
Yeah, it's probably. Anyway. Okay, wow.
That's a different podcast.
Yeah. So Burnham, one of the questions she wanted to ask was about her mother, you know, like what was that? She was like, I want to find out about what happened to my mother. They set that one up and they didn't go any. The closest they went with that is they talked for like a half second about the red angel suit. Mm-hmm. Just to say, like, well, you got some evidence for us? How about that red angel suit? It's like, nah, we threw that away. And they're like, okay. They never approached anything about... They never even said, like, we don't know anything about your mother. They just didn't even approach it. Because at the fact... Actually, what he did say is she asked him... I think she asked him something similar at first. And he was kind of like, we're not at liberty to say right now, you know, when he was being all coy or whatever. And then they just never followed up.
Well, I think he's not telling everything he knows about probably several topics.
There's that, but there's also that they're keeping the thematic... as well as the plot lines kind of semi-closed off in these episodes, where it is an ongoing story, but they're telling the story in more discrete chunks than they were before, you know, and this is, we mentioned this last week, where it's like, you know, you go here and then complete this mission. Okay, now you can move on to the next chunk of the story. And in this episode, it seemed like a lot of the themes were around sort of, you know, making an argument and backing it up and, you know, trust and building trust, like all the sort of interactions and relationships between people, you know, with, you know, you have this, what's it, Admiral Charles Vance, who does initially come off as a complete dickhead, but also, like, you're like, well, yeah, what else is he going to think, that some, like, loonies show up in some old, you know, Civil War reenactment style?
They found, like, a new crazy way to have, like, an admiral's, like, you know, like, the Starfleet Admiral's uniform is always something kind of ridiculous. They just found like a new way to do it in the future, but it looks like some kind of like old Confederate uniform.
It does look a little Confederate.
Yeah, that's a good point. I thought he was mostly reasonable. So they set it up kind of like how, you know, it was pretty evident that it wasn't going to go down exactly as they planned, you know, because they were just so like, oh yeah, of course they're going to do that. They're going to do that. And yes, he was very understandable. He's like, look, I don't think you're lying, but I need some evidence. There's too much on the line. Very reasonable. There was a couple things like he didn't have to do, though. For example, I mean, did he have to reassign the crew? Was that really like that's what he originally wanted to do, is to reassign, to split up the crew. That was what it was, is she asked him, why do you want to do that? That's right. No, they never talked about the mom thing at all. She asked him about, why do you want to split the fucking crew up?
Yeah.
And he was like, well, I can't tell you that right now. And he never ended up telling her why he wanted to split the crew up.
I think he was being like, sort of, it's sort of his natural instinct to be super practical. It's like, what can we, you know, how can we use these people without thinking it through all the way? But like, wait a minute, they're already kind of a unit already. Like,
yeah. And I understand why, you know, you'd want to split a crew up to make them less powerful for you, so they seem like less of a threat. But at the same time, it seems over
the
top.
You're both saying two different things, though. Similar things. Yeah. You're saying just what he and that both of them are correct in that Admiral Vance had a strategic reason why he didn't want these people to be all like together. If on the off chance there's some sort of like spies or holograms or monsters, but at the same time, as Jesse is implying, his whole thing is the Federation is in fucking pieces, and we're desperately trying to figure out how to like even just keep our local shit together.
They're more like the Rebel Alliance or something.
Yeah, it's like
the Federation.
Check it out. We just got all these new people that we can like use. They're all fresh. Their minds aren't all melted and stuff.
They have this positive outlook on the galaxy.
So what I'm saying, what you're saying is what I'm saying.
I think both two truths can live.
That's right. He did say that. I was saying that he was trying to make a tactical decision, and Jesse was more saying like he was trying to make. I was saying he was trying to make a tactical decision to like split up to make them less powerful, and Jesse was saying, "Oh, they need them in other spots," and he may have overlooked, you know, that it would be actually be more beneficial
treating them as units. you know, as if you're playing a real-time strategy game, you know, just your units, RTS. You're sending around to where you need them. I think both are true. I don't think they're mutually exclusive by any means. I think this is a smart fellow, and given his situation, at least what we can glean his situation is from what he's told us and what the implication has been, it would make sense. It is also kind of fucked up, and I think that's where Burnham really gets at that point, which is, you know, like old school Federation shouldn't be thinking like that. You know, they should be more like cool about it.
Yeah. So, right. So the point that I was making then, I guess, was that's very reasonable what you said, by the way. The end result, though, is that was the point where I thought he was perhaps being a little bit dickish. Maybe not dickish is not the right word, but that was when he was pushing it. Everything else, I was like, yeah, it's totally reasonable what he's doing. I was like, that one, I was like, you know.
There's a difference between justifiable and appreciating the style, right? Because he could have gone a slimy style. Yeah, he could have gone like, hey, guys, how's it going? And being all friendly and then sort of pulled the wool out from under them at some other point. So, and, you know, the writers, of course, are taking advantage of the common Trek trope that of the bad admiral, you know, the admiral that is straight up evil or is mildly corrupt or is not evil but is kind of an asshole about shit.
Kind of a cranky dude.
Yeah.
Or woman.
Yeah. And they do that here, but of course the difference is when it's resolved, you're kind of like, all right, everyone's on the same page. We get where you're. I mean, Saru even says to Burnham, he says, "Look, it's not that I want this to happen, but I totally understand his logic. I mean, what are you going to do? You wanted to come back to be in Starfleet, right? And that's what we're doing."
So with this episode, the only time I really felt like there was something on the line, I mean, there was something on the line the whole time, but the only time I ever felt there was a threat was around when they arrived on the ship, and he was like, "No, you're going to split up." I was like, oh, what's going to happen here? Once they got to the point where the Keelys and all that, you got to the point where they were just sort of, the episode was kind of a display of the Discovery's prowess, basically.
Yeah.
Because when they went on that mission, there was never any really vibe that they weren't going to succeed. Because the way they handled it, and I think that's good that they went that direction, because the way they handled it, it was there to show like, look, we're competent. You know, we may be from 1,000 years ago or whatever, because he was also kind of like treating him, you know, obviously, you know, someone from 1,000 years ago comes up to you and wants to help, you find some shit, you're just like, we got those logs, don't worry about it. But so whenever they were...
Meanwhile, the person from 1,000 years ago is staring at our glass pane windows and sliding doors and is like, how the hell did you do that?
How much technology do you think could, like, really advance in 1,000 years when it comes to space stuff, you know, because there's obviously,
and factoring in the problems they've had,
there's a lot of neat tricks they can do now that are awesome. But in terms of galactic knowledge, what, you know, how it's kind of like a curve, right? At first, you know, you get warp drive and then you discover a bunch of shit and everything's happening all at once. But I imagine at some point it's like asymptotic, where it's like, you know, when graphics get better on a computer or whatever, right? At a certain point, you know, you don't notice as much. You notice Atari to Nintendo a lot more than you notice, you know, one generation of graphics cards versus the next generation of graphics cards. Graphics cards!
We've got a lot of crazy G10 technology right now. It, obviously not like they do, but it's crazy to somebody from, you know, a couple hundred. If there was a some old sailing ship like sailed through a wormhole and got to our century,
iPhone would be crazy to somebody from 2002.
And our society is also crumbling. So, you know.
Yeah, so that's why. But that's what I mean. They have a lot
of parallels.
Yeah. They have a lot of neat.
What you call progress, I call the rape of the natural world.
They have a lot of neat tricks like moving floors and floating chairs and a lot of crazy shit they can do. But the basic idea of being able to travel, they don't have. And so knowledge of...
There's some things that are... Yeah.
So knowledge of technology is one thing, but knowledge of space itself, are they really that much more advanced than the Discovery era of what... Like, because, you know, Burnham's talking about when we came out of the wormhole, there was a disruption of this field and that thing happened, blah, blah, blah. And she's probably talking right on the level of what they would know at this point about what was going on with that wormhole. You know?
Right, yeah.
So it's not like they got that far ahead.
They probably had all that stuff and then the burn happened and things happened with travel and communications, but everybody already knew about stuff already. And if it's still sticking around, that means that they probably knew about it for a long time. Like, so it's probably been a few centuries where they've had programmable matter, whatever the fuck that is.
I will also
they've been time traveling for centuries because they had to outlaw time travel.
Yeah.
I'll add in the anthropologic reminder that even though Star Trek does not always get this correct, there's nothing that says technology has to advance in some sort of particular way or order, or that it can't regress and then shoot forward and go in different ways. You know, like, for example, if you're aliens on an ocean planet, you're going to, you know, you're going to invent different shit than if you're people on a rock planet.
Right. Obviously. And I was never saying that this was like an issue I had with.
I wasn't talking about you. It's more about Star Trek has this tendency of like they set up a world where they kind of make us think that. Mm-hmm. But then when it's convenient, like in this situation, you know, we don't know exactly. We know they have it more advanced technology in a lot of ways, but they don't know about a spore drive.
Yeah.
Right? They just don't know about that.
Yeah. Right. You know, it must...
Like you said, the wormhole knowledge is probably somewhat similar.
Yeah. And I guess when you're living like when you're traveling through space and you're meeting cultures that have lived through various points of evolution, you're dealing with people who have just found warp drive, who have known warp drive for, you know, 1,000 years longer than you. You're meeting people from all over the place. So I guess it really is a skill to find a common ground to be able to, you know, leverage people from different eras and work together when you're all in such varying states of evolution.
I think the other point would be that you could imagine, it would be perfectly reasonable to imagine a civilization that invents all sorts of other crazy stuff way before they even think of warp drive. Mm-hmm. and the inverse, somebody who invents warp drive in the equivalent to like our 1960s, just somehow figures that shit out. Just like we figured out how to put people, you know, on the moon after launching an airplane in, you know, the early 1900s, right? By the late 1960s, we're like landing people on the moon because there was a peculiar series of events that resulted in us wanting to figure out how to do that shit.
And that, yeah, that's the thing, is that it's a series of events and that can lead to all sorts of different kinds of necessity and requirements. Like, and like going to the moon, like if we had kept up with that as intensely as we did, you know, we might be in some crazy shit.
Like a lot more stuff started happening with computers when we started to try to figure out how to get to the moon.
Mm-hmm. You
know? Yeah, right. Well,
like,
I think
like computer,
doing the math.
Computer technology like advanced like a whole bunch in the 60s.
Like, yeah, I remember like reading about how cell phones became possible because, you know, they had to figure out, I mean, they had to make technology lighter and lighter to get into space because rocket fuel is expensive.
Also, I think that the people wanted to just sort of aggravate the writers of TV shows because, like, once you got the cell phones, it got harder to do some plot lines.
Oh, you're talking about cell phones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you could just be like, you could be like, oh no, the murderer is going to their house. It's like, all right, I will give them a ring.
Yeah.
I'll call them up. Well, even if they're not at their house, they're not there. I'll call them on their cell phone.
X-Files would have some problems now.
Yeah, the X-Files would have them go. They were still in the era where you could go out of range a lot.
Yeah.
That excuse gets weaker and weaker as time goes on.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't know, something's weird with my cell phone. It's like, bullshit.
It's like, well, use the fucking internet. send me an email or something.
In Congo, they had these futuristic suitcases that allowed you to like contact satellite, you know, telephones or something. I remember.
Oh, yeah.
But, So what I was going back to, sort of the episode is when they went on their mission part in the last half of the episode, like I said, there was never a point where it ever felt like they weren't going to succeed or something crazy was going to happen. Yeah. There wasn't going to be... Actually, though, there was, I guess, something crazy with Nan, but I mean, that was kind of a side thing. But
not...
There was no catastrophic failure.
You're describing, I think, what people like about this. You're describing an episode of Star Trek. Strange aliens that we've never met before are suffering from some ailment. Our crew is uniquely suited to help them and then goes and helps them with a few challenges along the way that make them question morals and themselves.
And I guess it stood out because this is Discovery and that doesn't often take that point as much.
So, we've seen hints of it more and more, a lot of hints of it in this particular season, in the third season. I think this episode was the most... You know, we arrive, here's the instigating event, there's other stuff going on, but fundamentally we have to save these aliens to save ourselves, and then we have to have some moral quandaries. I'm using a silly voice, but I really liked it. I thought it was great.
Yeah, I did too.
It was comfortable.
Yeah, it was. And like I said, the only time I really felt like I didn't know what was going to happen was... when at first they arrived on the ship and he was kind of like being all sketchy, and we still don't know what's going on with Georgiou, but and then the non stuff happened, but yeah, it was on the one hand, depending on the show and the time it was placed, one could look at that as like, oh, well, there was nothing at stake, nothing ever felt at stake. But that's, yeah, like you just said, it felt comfortable, you know, it felt good the way they presented
it. We never thought Picard or Sisko were going to get, you know, murdered one day. Maybe they would have, you know, but if they had, they would have.
Tasha Yar got murdered.
Well, yeah, she did. She and it did happen. Captain, security officer, I was going to comment, security officers don't stick around a lot on Star Trek. Lieutenant Shax, you have Nan. Is she Commander? Commander Nan? I can't remember her rank.
Could have been a lieutenant.
Lieutenant. And then Lieutenant Yar.
Yar.
And it's another episode where they encounter a new group of people. Then they get the best welcome so far. By far.
Mm-hmm.
This is the best welcome.
Yeah, no one tried to fuck them up.
They didn't just try to blast them out of space.
They tried to break up the band.
It's like, okay, well, you're on the team, but we're going to, you know, exploit your stuff.
And they introduce a lot of opportunities for whimsy, starting with the interrogation scenes where everybody was entertaining. Culber was great with his whole, I was emotionally dead too.
Yeah, right.
That line. And
Nan is doing that thing where she's just giving like name, rank, and serial number. And, like, we don't even know what the Hollow was asking her. She's just like, no.
Yeah.
frustrated.
Yeah. Yeah. And then what Culber was like, my murderer and I are good now.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So that was good.
No.
But the best.
And then go for it.
I was just going to say the best was Janet. Janet Reno.
Janet Reno.
Jet
Reno.
That's what I was just about to say.
I'm going to need something to drink.
Repeated insistence on snacks and things like that.
She got some chips and salsa. Yeah. Really good.
There was a clue in there. Did anybody get, I wasn't able to quite get it because they, not a clue, I guess, but, you know, they were referring to the Andorian Orion Syndicate. But they referred to it as something else,
the Emerald Chain.
Oh, the Emerald Chain.
And Jet Reno was saying, she was like, is that some kind of Ryzen party drug? So
yeah, thank you for clearing that up for me, because I was I'm trying to soak up the lore, because
we're
learning about sort of the political dynamics and the cultural dynamics
It's funny that the Andorians and the Orions are still sort of causing trouble, but they've joined up now, I guess.
Yes.
So there's that. Yeah, and what was it? Stamets was made a reference to Detmer, you know, because...
Mm. Oh, yeah. Have you been talking to Detmer?
Yeah, because he's saying about essential personnel, and then Tilly was just being Tilly, you know.
Well, and this was also where we see something that Discovery's actually done a lot, in that they... Discovery's already filmed it, I think it was like 2.39:1 super wide frame aspect ratio to be very cinematic. And they do something that was highlighted in this interrogation scene where they have people all the way at one side of the frame. Except if you think of sort of older school stuff like Pulp Fiction, a lot of Tarantino stuff, he puts people at the far edges of the frame, but talking to each other with very little space behind them. But in Discovery, I've seen it elsewhere too, but Discovery a lot, they'll put somebody in the frame, they're like looking out to the right, but they're like all the way to the right side of the frame with all this open space behind them. It just gives a different feel. Yeah. And it'll switch back and forth, and the people will look like they're all close to each other with all this space behind them.
That's why those rooms look so massive.
It helps, but it's also it's uncomfortable. I think it's designed to make you a little uncomfortable. I mean, Discovery is a very well-produced show, and they have a lot of great directors. But we see a lot of the placement of the characters in the frame makes a difference. And a couple times in this episode, and we've seen it before, when the character's in the center of the frame, they're often framed by something else as well. The most clear example in this episode, when Nan stays behind on that seed ship and she watches the Discovery, you know, use the spore drive to get away. And then it shows Commander Nan and she's framed by all those plants around her.
I did notice that was
and
cool.
She's all, you know, and then you see a similar thing when Saru and Burnham are looking out the window and it pulls back at the end of the episode. They're dead center of the frame.
Yeah. When Nan was looking out at the ship and, framed by all the plants and stuff, like you were saying, it made it feel like she's in this like small cozy spot looking at this giant thing in the wide open flying away. And I was thinking about how awesome that must look, and that scene would benefit from just like a little VR demo if you were like in the eyes of Nan there and looking out some window and watching, you know, Discovery, like to do the zip zappity zoo, you know, and that would look really awesome. I can imagine like something that huge just flying
Black
around.
Alert.
Black Alert. Yeah, Black Alert. That's awesome.
It is awesome.
Okay, real quick, Burnham commented on Nan's eyes when she took off her breathing apparatus.
Her eyes were normally blue. 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 Blue.
Blue. Blue. Blue. Blue. Blue.
Blue.
Blue.
I need to get on a diet.
So,
but that's okay.
To me, her eyes looked normal when she was on Discovery. Then when she was on eyes were like whitish, glazed over white, and then when she took off her thing, it looked like her eyes went back to looking like they did before on the Discovery.
I think they were blue and then went to brown.
Yeah, it was hard for me to tell because
she had blue contacts. And then now she never. Maybe it's as simple as the actress didn't want to wear those blue eyes anymore.
Yeah, I
don't know.
I remember before she took it off, while she was on the takeoff, it very specifically looked like nothing I'd remembered seeing before. It was very white and
glazed
over.
Like I'm wearing nothing at all.
Nothing at all. I was a little confused by.
I don't know.
I was expecting her eyes to be white and glazed over all the time.
Honestly, I mentioned earlier there are a few lines of dialogue that are just a little weird, and I thought that was one of them. It was sort of
it's like your eyes.
Okay. I mean, the line was nice, which was like, you know, real air, real me, or something. That line is cool. I don't know why the eyeballs were the important focus.
Yeah, her eyeballs never really stuck out to me. Maybe I'll have to look in the past and figure it out. It was cool when back to the opening when they went into when they went inside the distortion bubble, right, and they saw talking about some neutronium alloy fibers, talking about theoretical, it was talking about organic hull. Some were comprised of holograph containment walls. So you got holograph walls.
Yeah.
Which is kind of neat to think about.
Flying rainforest.
Yeah, yeah. So when Tilly talks about the flying rainforest and everyone's like, that made me feel all squishy inside.
Yeah, very squishy.
Yeah. I was like, it's a flying. It was like the climax.
The power of math.
The what?
That's one of her famous phrases.
What was her phrase?
The power of math.
Oh, is that? Does she say that often?
No, just one time.
Oh, okay.
Because she used math.
Yeah.
Calculations.
Yeah, power of math is powerful. Math just is, man. It rules.
Just is.
Math just is, man. It
always was.
I was a little confused about the detached nacelles. I don't even know. She was like,
were a little confused about that, too.
Yeah. They were saying, where do they even put the warp core? But we didn't really see the example of it, so I didn't really get a good feeling in my mind of what she meant by detached nacelles. Did she mean they were floating along with the ship, or were they replaceable? Or replaceable...
Just very spindly?
Yeah, because if you look at, Star Trek TOS, or the Enterprise, rather... they have those struts, so they... Seems like it could be because the Discovery, their nacelles are kind of like dug in there, but the Enterprise, they look like they could be. I don't know what they. I didn't understand.
Maybe
what you meant.
It was a mild reference to the Enterprise J, which is seen at one point during Star Trek Enterprise when Captain Archer is briefly thrown forward into the future. Far into the future, related to the temporal wars. Which Discovery has referenced as well.
That's true, yeah.
And sort of closing the loop on that. And the Enterprise J is this crazy design that caused Star Trek fans like a schism in the fans because some people were like, oh, that's super cool. Other people were like, that's ridiculous. Right. And by all accounts, the guy who designed it, I forget who it was, if it was... Trumbull, or I can't remember who designed Trumbull it. I apologize. He said that he liked the negative reaction because he's like, that's what I set out to do. Something along the, I'm paraphrasing, of course, but something along the lines of like, I got set out to aggravate some people and get them, because it's the future and ships are going
to
be crazy.
You want it to shock people and make people think like it's too crazy to even think
about.
But
yeah, y'all look up the Enterprise J.
Oh yeah, it's upside down or something. It's weird.
It's got super like skinny nacelle things. It's just weird. It's just like a weird setup.
And then they're like
it's
going
all flat.
It's all flat. flat. It's going up from the. It's. It looks like a saucer, which you know the Enterprise does, but it looks like a. An, it looks even more like an alien UFO saucer with that attached some kind of handle to the top of it or something weird like that.
Weird.
Yeah, it's really weird.
There's some crazy stuff going on out there. But anyway, maybe it was a slight reference to that. I could have done with a few more beauty shots, but. I was happy with what we got. We got to see some stuff. And with luck, we will see more as either this season progresses or the next, whatever that will, you know, because if we're hopeful Star Trek people, we're going to see some form of activity, you know, improvement in the fate of the Federation and or Starfleet.
Yeah, I mean, they've sort of established that this is some going to be maybe not a home I mean, it is the, their home base, but maybe in terms of what the show is concerned with, they're going to. It would seem reasonable that they would contact, you know, back at this, you know, in the future. Speaking of Jay, there was that's what the USS Voyager was Jay as well, which is 10 or 11 generations.
11 because the first one had no letter. Although, okay, real quick, there's a funny little debate going on the internet, and I'm just going to comment on it because I don't want to be one of those assholes who just assumes that my perspective is the correct one. I mean, I do assume that, but I don't want to, like, you know, assume that.
Yeah.
I want to be open and
you can be
ready.
You can be confident in your opinion and still just like, oh, but it's not an opinion to you.
It's not an opinion. No, this is an opinion, but I think it's an informed and educated opinion.
There you go.
Informed and educated by Star Trek lore. In that you see the Voyager J, and I immediately presumed that was, you know, the 11th ship called Voyager, you know, just like the Enterprise and then the Enterprise A and the Enterprise B.
Oh, yeah, right.
And Enterprise C, you know, that's what I understand. But I saw people, I even saw an article that was like, well, clearly they actually mean that this is the original Voyager that's just been evolved
over
time.
refitted
11 generations worth. And I don't understand how you come to that conclusion, but stating it in case I'm totally off base and I sort of misinterpreted something.
So, well, they actually used the words evolution on the show. Now, I didn't interpret it as an evolution in terms of they kept
a single ship. Yeah,
a single ship.
Evolution is in engineering design.
So, yeah, it was, I think it was Owashakan was saying that.
Owashakan?
I think, was it what?
Owashakan?
Oh, was it Owashakan? I thought it was Owashakan.
I don't know, actually.
Don't look at me.
I don't know what's actually the right way.
Yeah, Burnham calls her Owo.
Yeah,
for sure. Now
that's a lot shorter.
Anyways, I think it was her that said, corrected Detmer and said 11 generations of evolution. Either that or Detmer.
She said, no, she said 11 because
instead of Detmer said 10.
Because J is the 10th letter of the alphabet, right? A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I,
the point,
J.
Okay,
I was confirming that for myself.
Right, the point. Okay.
That was not a mocking.
No.
I'm sorry, folks. It's just Dan looked at me like I was being an asshole. I just wanted to confirm that J was the 10th. The Voyager is the first, and then you have 10 ships, thus the letter J.
So the only point I was getting at is it was the word, it was like generations of evolution was word. It was
word.
Was
word.
How it was worded.
It was word.
And
word.
So,
radical.
And so
word up.
That's the only reason I could think someone would think that they would keep changing the ship around. But like what I just said, I just assumed that was just another way of saying, you know, it's they keep making new ones over time. Like, why would they suddenly take a ship and just
why would they add letters? Because when they refit the Enterprise many times, they didn't add a letter to it. They only added a letter to it when they got a brand new one.
And eventually you just want to...
slightly used
and
one.
And eventually you just want to rebuild some shit to, like, you know, because there's only so many times you can patch something up, you know? I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, it just doesn't seem... Does
the ship
seem
of Theseus.
After a while. You know, and when there was the up-the-butt shot of the Discovery going towards the
I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
I didn't realize that cargo bay took up so much space of the ship. I guess it makes sense,
that's
but,
a big
like,
one, yeah.
It was big, you know? It was big.
And again, my personal headcanon, I think I've mentioned it in the past, is that it's the design of the ship is a function of the spore drive, or is somehow related to it, which is why, you know, it has so much crew, but has lots of space in it because they just, for engineering reasons,
and
like a stealth fighter has to be certain angles.
Yeah,
and stuff,
the
right?
saucer, of course, is in these like inner and outer ring sort of design parts.
So maybe they need more space because of that.
Yeah. I noticed, though, after they were, and you know, Tilly said, oh, flying rainforest. And then everyone went to the window and looked out the window and everyone was amazed. Then they had that up the butt shot and it was, it looked like there was all this flashing in the cargo bay. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that was meant to mean anything. And I was thinking,
Are there people sparking up J's so they could then go look out the window with all the marvelous stuff?
I mean, that makes more sense because I was thinking like,
space J's.
I was thinking, are they all taking pictures? Is that their flash? And I was like, that doesn't make any sense at all.
They'd be taking pictures out the back.
Yeah, I know. And it's like there's these bright flashes out the back. It's like I didn't know. Yeah, they were, I guess they were lighting some, sparking some kind of fire.
They were just on Earth, so they picked
sparking
up a bunch, some of,
future
bunch
doobies.
Of space weed.
Yeah, snake, they got some snake leaf.
Snake leaf and what's, I don't remember the other drugs they do out in space, but yeah, I didn't know what that flashing was all about.
Kranya.
So nobody, did you notice that flashing?
Yeah, I noticed the flashing on the second viewing. I did really, I thought it was really sweet, the people looking out the window.
Yeah.
Appropriate. I mean, you'd expect that to happen.
It was a nice scene, because like we got to enjoy all this cool new shit with them.
Yeah. All right, so we've jumped around a lot, but I think we don't want to forget to talk about, since we already discussed the other interrogation scenes, the scene between Georgiou first messing around with the hologram interrogators.
Yeah, it was cool.
And then fucking David Cronenberg
is just
hanging out in the corner, wearing glasses and being all weird and creepy. Before I forget, I really need to point out his dialogue precisely matched not in words, but the style of his dialogue, the cadence of it, the topic, the manner of arguing, the manner of interfacing was identical to Sloan from Deep Space Nine. And I think, first of all, I don't think it's any surprise that people assume this guy is Section 31.
Right.
I mean, it's David Cronenberg. There's a few rumors as to what his name might actually be, but it wasn't mentioned in this episode.
Some people refer to him as the guy with glasses.
The guy with the cigarette.
The cigarette
smoking, whatever.
I don't mean to say anything like he's Sloan revisited or anything. I'm just saying that I think the writers have made a choice to evoke Section 31 by using, and I didn't do a detailed analysis, so trust me on this one, folks. Go back and watch it and see if you agree with me. And if you do, like and subscribe. Rate and review.
Subscribe and like.
Well, the deal with the sphere data was that the problem was is the sphere data is fine. It's just that people were trying to put it in Arium. They were trying to get Arium to put the sphere data inside the control, which was something that was either created or harvested by Section 31, right?
Section 31 was playing around with the control because it was making like a super AI to help them do spy shit.
Yeah, and so this guy, Glasses Man, he was kept, you know, interrogating Georgiou about like the burn, I guess, which she was a suspect or not her specifically, but her people, or maybe she'd have some insight because Terrans, oh no, you know, their space has been moving, their universe has moved away from our universe. Maybe like something crazy happened and who knows, but you know, maybe it's just that like he's secretly trying to get at the sphere data or whatever.
He might be, when done properly, the fun of Section 31 is that you can never be sure what exactly they're going for because there's so many things it could be. And in the best case scenario, it's something you didn't expect, which they did manage to do a lot on Deep Space Nine. I think season two of Discovery, which I enjoyed, I agree with some of the criticisms that the way they handled Section 31 was a little bit weird, just because it was different than Section 31 really was intended to be in the first place. And one example that does come to mind that reminded me of Sloan is that when Sloan interacted with Bashir, especially after a certain point, once Bashir sort of caught on that something was a little weird, when Sloan interacted with Bashir, he did that whole interrogation technique, that communication technique of being super honest. And straight up saying like, here's the deal. You're a very smart person. I'm not going to pretend you're not. I know you're going to lie to me. So I'm going to tell you that I'm happy to hear your questions because I will get information from your questions. Right? And that reminded me so much of just some of the interactions that Sloan would have with Bashir, because he was speaking with Bashir on a similar level. I mean, part, and the situation was similar in that he was trying to recruit Bashir into Section 31. And of course, we've already made this leap. It could be we're totally fucking wrong, and it turns out David Cronenberg is just like a creepy old dude, and he has nothing to do with Section 31. But it's fun to talk about, I think, presuming we're on the right track there, and presuming that this is what leads to the eventual Section 31 spinoff. I will say it made me more interested than I was previously in the Section 31 spinoff, particularly if David Cronenberg is involved in even just a minor occasional showing up or something, or is in the pilot episode or something. I was really impressed with this scene between the Michelle Yeoh and David Cronenberg.
It was a good scene. It really held my attention. I don't know what the fucking word for it is.
Because I was going on the highlight clip. Right there.
It was good.
It was riveting.
Riveting. Yes, it was riveting. That's a good word.
You were riveted.
I couldn't use that word 30 seconds ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why didn't you tell me earlier? Why didn't you
You're
help?
Hoarding all your fucking words, man.
Well, I'm dying over here.
I'm not the guy that just yells out words. It's like, what are you trying to say? You're trying to say Lollapalooza. I don't know what you're trying to say.
Onomatopoeia.
Onomatopoeia.
So, I mean, that would make sense that the whole Section 31 thing, I mean, it might not be it at all, like you said, but I mean, you know, she's Terran. He keeps talking to her about being,
He's really into the Terran stuff.
Yeah, he's super fascinated by their duplicitous behavior as they tried to pull some, like, sort of, like, weird, like, make up some lie about biology, how to do with biology and stuff. I think it was just a shaker or something. I don't know. But she didn't get shaken until he mentioned the part about you're on Discovery because you like someone on there.
Yeah, right.
And that's when she was, that's the only point where that was the first time Georgiou's ever been really visibly shaken.
Yeah, and then it switches to the scene where you see Michael Burnham walking around because she likes Michael Burnham.
Yeah, right.
She thinks of her as like a daughter.
Yeah, they do that thing where they switch the scene to the person they're talking about, but don't say it.
Georgiou wants to bone Lioness, but wants to mother Burnham.
Yeah.
Bone Lioness.
Bone. But, I mean, so it would follow that, like, you know, that and on top of that, at the end of the episode, she just zonked out for a reason.
And that's very interesting.
And on top of that, why did they hold her longer than it? No, first of all, nobody seemed to notice or care that Georgiou was the only person being interrogated longer than
anyone
else.
In a different place, by different people, by a different person.
Two hollows.
I mean, I guess they could just thought, well, if that's Georgiou, she just does shit on her own.
That's my Georgiou!
Right. You know, I don't know, but it seemed weird that nobody seemed to care that she was missing, but at the same time, yeah, like a totally different interrogation. The other interrogation scenes, like you said, were whimsical and kind of fun and comedic, and this one was the one where...
And when we see her in the hallway at the end, it's immediately you start thinking, wait a second, is this... was she in shock? Did he do something to her with his glasses? Is she a
stupid glasses?
Because it did start out a bit comedic because she was being all snappy, and I'm going to say snappy stuff and play with words, and I'm going to blink out your hollows. And
but is she?
I'm the greatest.
She could be a hologram. She could be an android. She could be in shock or concerned or weird. But the behavior was acutely bizarre. Right. It wasn't because if it was just lost in thought, then it would have been lost in thought. And then Michael Burnham says, hey, a second time. And then she's like, oh, hey, how's it going?
Yeah.
But this was like a weird, if you came across somebody like this, you'd be like, you should go to the sick bay.
Yeah. She didn't space out for a second. She was somewhere else
and
for a while.
Standing all weirdly straight.
Yeah.
Her eyes were funny.
Almost like sleepwalking or something, maybe hypnotism or something. But she did show concern. Her last flash of Georgiou's face, after she kind of comes to, she responds to Michael like, why would you ask me that? And then she walks away, but she has this look of fuck.
She's like, yeah.
She's like, yeah, is she catching on to me? Or what? Like, I don't know. It was weird.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see where that goes.
Oh, she was also shaken. She was actually even kind of a little put off guard a second before that when he told her that the Terrans fell centuries ago. Yes. You could tell that kind of fucked her up a little bit too. And he talked about how their universes have not
crossed in a while.
It's like 500 years and they started separating since her departure, and then, you know, Yeah, and that's when she was like, the weakness of people is generally other people. And she was being all clever, and he was like saying, oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Well, you are weak.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah, well, you're weak for another person. And she's like, fuck. And so that's like, that was when she was all fucked up.
He's all like, checkmate.
Yeah. So... It was weird that the hologram blinking thing. That was a weird.
Yeah, borderline silly.
Yeah, it kind of was.
Borderline silly.
She goes, blinking at their harmonic rate disrupts the hollow protocols, creating a reference loop that shuts them down. Like, you'd think that would be some kind of, day one security flaw that they should have patched.
This was another example. The third example I'm citing of, I think where the dialogue got a little bit weird in that she's doing the blinking thing, okay. But then she's also saying, what if you're a human who's actually programmed to think you're a hologram?
Right.
Which would be a completely different strategy to take. I guess here they're saying she's combining the two, but I don't know. Right. I just thought from a narrative perspective, pick one or the other. Either trick them through some sort of computer logic or use your blinking thing. The computer logic thing would probably be more interesting.
I did think that was funny how she did both of those. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, no criticism, just a critique.
Yeah. And what was the line? She goes, when they say all Terrans are duplicitous by their biology.
Biology.
Biology. And she goes, or by biplicitous by our duology.
Yeah.
Neither ology has anything to do with it. That was just kind of like, okay, so what? I mean, it was a clever sort of...
And she's the one who was saying, just because you have a... Remember in the second episode, he was like, just because you have a... use fancy words doesn't mean you're...
Right.
Exactly.
Right. Hard, it just means you have a thesaurus.
Yeah, exactly. It was kind of like, that was very sort of... clever thing you did to make the words sound different, but right, it was like, yeah, I didn't even think about that. That's a good point. She
was just making up words. Biplicitous, that's not a word.
Yeah, she was.
I think duology might be a word.
She was just saying things.
Yeah,
she was just saying things.
That's what she does.
Where do you get off just saying things?
She's
just
that lady says stuff.
Oh, and that reminds.
Ooh,
I'm sorry. 454. Where are you?
I love that the percentage of our audience that knows what Car 54 is is so small.
I bet it's small.
It's so small.
Gunther,
write in. Don't look it up. It's cheating if you look it up on Google. Don't look up Car 54. If you know it. From being a human and experiencing Car 54.
Perhaps old.
The question is not, name a scene from Car 54. Where are you? The question is, did that...
Don't name an actor.
Did that tingle your flingles?
Fred Quinn.
Fred Quinn. That's exactly what I was going to say, yes.
So this is a bit of a jump, and we can talk more about
and that guy from the other guy from the Munsters.
Oh yeah,
jump in the line. Oh yeah, the other guy, Uncle.
Yeah,
what's his name?
The guy that played Uncle somebody, Uncle Dracula.
So when Georgiou talking about fancy words,
what
and then she uses fancy words. What about the scene with Culber where he's all shitting on that dude, Atler or Addis?
Addis, Dr. Addis.
Addis, about dead people, which seems like a reasonable thing to do. But Culber,
he's not shitting on the dude.
He was being kind of a dick about it.
I think he was, he wants to help the guy.
He goes, okay, so what's something about, he hasn't gone crazy, if that's what you're suggesting, is what Nan says. And he goes, well, his family is clearly deceased, and he won't accept that. Like,
if you're a doctor...
But he's not saying it to the dude.
If you're you gotta help the live people. You can't help the dead people anymore, so you gotta move on and start helping some people that are alive.
Right, and he didn't say it to the dude, and you're right, you gotta help the live people as a doctor, but he died! He fucking died!
Maybe that's why he's like, get over yourself.
But he came back.
He came back, so why can't they? Because they wasn't the spore drive.
Because they're dead.
See, that's the thing, is like, normally, I'd be on his side about this one, but he should have a little bit of give when it comes to something that he dealt himself. Now, granted, this family didn't go through the same shit he did, but, think it would open your mind up to some unknowns, right?
It's they might have done a better job in stating more clearly how fucked up your body's going to be from a coronal mass injection. The radiation from that is just going to be... And what I will agree with you, one thing that didn't help was that in the in the stasis pods. The family looked all sort of nice.
Mm. Right.
Which might be, I don't know, maybe that's even scientifically accurate. But the idea, it would be better if they looked all mangled and horrific. And then we would identify more with Culber. But obviously they didn't want us to. Obviously they wanted us to feel sympathy for this guy, Dr. Addis, and to understand his position.
I swear that actor looked familiar.
He may have been.
He looked like he'd been in another episode of TNG, but I don't think he was. But he looked exactly like some kind of...
There's a type that they go after.
Yeah.
Be all Star Trek-y. The Star Trek type.
And it was almost like the people in the future didn't know what a coronal mass ejection was.
The one Willa. Doctor,
Lieutenant Willa, yeah.
But she's also security.
She's security. She's not a science person. Because I've even heard of that shit, and I'm from the 20th century.
Mm-hmm.
21st, too, I guess. I'm not really from it. I just got here.
Well, you inhabited it.
I just got here.
And then... I remember that. So in that same scene, they were talking about like how he was out of sync with himself. He was just, yeah. Nan was saying he was out of. Burnham was saying his entire body was out of sync. Nan was like he was out of sync with or out of phase. And okay, Burnham said his entire body was out of phase. Nan said, yeah, it seemed like he's out of sync. And then Burnham's like, hey, Culber, any idea what could have caused this? And he says, well, we could examine him. We couldn't tell. Blah blah blah. But from what you're saying, his grief seems to have disconnected him from reality. Okay, yes, his grief disconnected him from reality.
And being phased out.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I get it in the sense that, like, oh, he thinks they're alive when they're actually dead. But, like, right, so he...
His face is going all weird.
He said it directly after they were talking about why is he phasing out. He's like, well... He's got this grief and he's disconnected from reality and it literally manifests itself in disassociating his entire physical form.
Okay, you're convincing me a little bit that that's a...
It was weird.
Yeah, it's a...
Space.
Compact.
Yeah.
Well, okay.
I think they tried to skip to that... They were trying to skip to the next idea and it didn't transition well, I think. I think they tried to transition to the idea of him being disconnected, which is why he thought they were still alive when... He thinks,
and again,
he thinks totem pole.
The theme in this episode is building trust. You know, Saru and Burnham with Vance, with Admiral Vance, and Burnham with Addis, and Culber with this and that. You know, there's a lot of that in this episode. It's very Star Trek. There's a lot of super Star Trek stuff in this episode, particularly on the ship. Right, there is the phased out guy.
Mm-hmm.
Who somehow survived because of some weird thing?
Because he was in the transporter.
It's like on Lower Decks.
He was in the buffer. Mm-hmm. He was in the buffer array or something while the star burp.
Yeah, Jesse makes a good point that I hadn't considered. This is what happened to Boimler on Lower
Except
Decks.
Except he wasn't making noises like Boimler was.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Right. Noise. Some shit goes down while you're being beamed in that buff transport buffer.
Then you had the overly complicated seed container, which was super.
Oh, yeah.
That was weird. Yeah.
It was overly complicated in two ways. First of all, the basic setup just seemed weirdly overly complicated. Yeah. And then when they retrieved the seeds, it was like turning on all the lights in some weird order. And it's like, yeah. I don't understand.
Everything's a different shape.
Because it's down here. It's so like... why didn't it just come out? Why does like lights have to go? And it's, but that's not a complaint. And, that's Star Trek. That's like the hilarious, awesome Star Trekiness.
And I didn't even really begin. I sort of wrote it off the minute it popped into my head. I was like, this has got all the seeds from like all of the galaxy that they've traveled. You know, I don't know how high that ceiling is. But I don't know about that, man. You know, considering how much space one of those things
was the light somehow bringing the seeds down and then they pop
out?
I don't know.
Were they phased out and then they phased? I didn't know. I was like, I don't know how you can fit all of... Because we got millions of fucking shit here on Earth. Imagine, you know, in
Yeah, why didn't the seeds get hit by the coronal mass injection?
Oh, they were hidden inside because they were hidden inside
in
the vault.
Some stuff.
That's why you can't. You have to transport in and out. There's that to make it even extra secure.
Yes.
So
okay,
the vault was entirely too small. There's no way that vault was big enough to hold all the seeds from all the Federation.
I also think this is intended if you believe in the concept of a seed ship to save seeds, you will also believe in the concept of not putting all your eggs in one basket.
Yeah.
So presumably there are other ships as well.
Yeah. Well, then how'd they know the right seeds were on that ship?
I don't know. Because it was local to the plant life before it got polluted.
I seem to remember them saying something about how they were all the seeds. But like I said, it's that,
yeah,
that
they
detail,
probably did.
That detail was just, yeah, it's just like, whatever. It doesn't
there's
matter.
Not that much life.
What are you
going to
do?
In
it's Star Trek, Jake.
There's not many what?
There's not that much life in the galaxy.
Dude.
I mean, yeah.
There's like three life.
What are you fucking talking about?
Dude.
It's all spread out.
Imagine how many seeds there are on the Earth.
I know. I'm just playing.
Oh, you're just fucking with me. You're just taking advantage of my fuckability.
But I do like, okay. There were production elements that were very Star Trek, like the seed thing. Mm-hmm. The whole look of the ship was very, it was modernized, but you know, with the hanging plants and stuff, it was very old school. I like that.
Some kind of person moving around, like where the background's all sort of like distorted because it's a half invisible person.
We've already discussed
that's happened in TNG a lot,
and we've already discussed that this is already a very classic Star Trek structure in that they have to save the Keeley. But then this is a sort of a mini version of it because now they're on this thing and now they have to save this guy address this guy's pain and tragedy in order to accomplish the larger mission.
And then also somehow still maintain the standards of Starfleet by not letting this guy kill himself.
And what I thought was, again, part of the theme of this episode, but also just great classic Star Trek, is you have Culber, Nan, and Burnham all discussing how to proceed, and all of them are making 100% legitimate points, right? All of their perspectives are legitimate. It just comes down to, as Burnham said, sometimes there's no good choice, only ones you can live with, right? Mm-hmm. So in other words, it's we have to make a decision. There's good and bad about, this is not a matter of 100% right and 100% wrong. It's about balancing things, and any answer could be justified, but no answer could be justified 100%. No answer is not going to result in something bad not happening, right? And that is, again, that's what we enjoy looking at, I think, in these types of stories, where you play around with that dilemma in your head. Picard was good at this, although a lot of times on TNG, we were sort of led to be like, oh, the way they did it was the right way.
Yeah, that's true.
Deep Space Nine, Voyager, Voyager with the whole Tuvix business is an example of what's the right answer.
And the cloned Trip Tucker from Enterprise, which they...
Charles Trip Tucker.
Which they arguably didn't treat with enough respect.
Yes.
Tuvix.
Tuvix is a good one, but they're, you know, In the Pale Moonlight. Even things like Homefront on Deep Space Nine, where we might ultimately agree with how the main characters acted, but you had antagonists that you couldn't easily dismiss. Mm-hmm. They couldn't be just summarily dismissed as mustache twirling bad guys, right? Mm-hmm.
Why did they have to ask that guy's permission to take the seeds anyway, though? Were they just, I mean, they really saw it as
well, he
super...
locked out the system, presumably.
Did he lock out the
system? Well, she tried to, they had that cute little scene where she's like, oh, damn it. It's just like, it wasn't recognizing the voice imprint or whatever.
Okay, yeah. Oh, yeah, right.
Now, you could argue that as Starfleet on a high level mission from the Admiral would be able to override that somehow. So again, headcanon in this case could say that the guy, Dr. Addis, in his pain, locked it out special, extra hard, because he just was goofing around a little bit.
Yeah, they were dying of radiation. That family would have looked a little more fucked up, I would think.
I guess it depends on the radiation.
He's trying to find a cure for radiation. His face is folded in on itself before he disappeared. There was a lot of folding going on, because then they were talking about...
folded proteins or something?
Yeah, it was prions. Yeah, they were talking about...
Prions with the Keeley.
Yeah, I think that's a real thing. Prions folding in on itself.
That's mad cow disease. Jakob Creutzfeldt.
Oh, bummer.
It's a prion disease.
Yeah.
There was a hollow plane of the family on the seed ship, and somebody was singing that mystery melody that Adair was playing on the cello.
Yeah, and that was the first time that was introduced, the idea of this common...
Yes, this episode.
Yeah, and then it turns out that other people have heard that.
Which has
some kind of...
very Battlestar Galactica vibes to it, because there is, for those who haven't seen it, there is a key plot line that is associated with the music in a similarly mysterious yet also scientific way.
I was thinking that maybe it's going to lead them to some discovery of some kind of alternate message system.
That's the name of the ship.
Discovery. They're going to Voyager to...
Like, this is another clue. Like, you had a bunch of clues in the second season. This is one of those clues.
That, well, maybe it's like a... Yeah, well, it's like a clue that maybe there's an alternate sort of subspace or something. Yeah. Or there's a subspace that works or... I don't know. Some other way of communicating. And the reason everyone knows this tune maybe is because they were able to...
The ether.
There's some kind of new form of communication. Just like the spore drive is a new form of travel.
Right. Horizon Fios. But like future version of Ryan.
They're just using future Fios.
It's like Fios. It's Starlink.
Starlink.
Starlink. Starling.
Starlings fucking suck, man.
Feedback.
You know, that Dr. Willow was being super unhelpful on that when she was talking about, you know, let's see what this stupid piece of shit can do. Yeah, How is that helping anybody?
Yeah, it's...
She's just being an asshole.
Yeah, and what was it she was, like, talking about, like, when she found out... Barzan? Is that the name of the... Barzans.
Yeah, Barzans.
Barzans. Yeah, the Barzans.
People saw them, I think, on... TNG. I was about to say Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Well, there's the Benzars, which have a different face.
The Benzars.
Those are
different.
Yeah,
but they also have the breathy
things. They have the breathy things.
Benzars or Benzites.
The Benzarinos.
Yeah.
But they're
Benzites. Barzans, their planet is Benzar.
Barzans were also on TNG.
So yeah. And then
there was some negotiating of some treaties going on.
She was, and so they were talking about, you know, Nan was all happy because she found out they joined the Federation, and it's like, oh, we're going to the ship, and then, you know, Burnham's like, yeah, you should come along, and she's like, great. And then Lieutenant Willa is just being a jerk again. She's reminding them of something they already knew. Yeah. Which was basically saying, well, don't take too long, is essentially what she said. You know, it's kind of like...
Isn't that when Burnham is just like, anyway?
Yeah, she does. Totally. Because it's not
got a
fucking,
spore drive.
It's not fucking helpful. It's like, have you ever been, I don't know, like moving a couch or something with somebody, and the other person keeps going, careful,
I know,
careful,
it's like, yeah.
Careful. It's like, what do you think I'm trying to do?
Right.
Oh, thank you. Now that you told me to be careful.
I'm going to drop your couch.
I'm not going to want to throw it out the window anymore.
I'm going to flip it over on you.
It's like when you're going on a trip and your parents are like, don't get in a car accident.
Yeah, right. So, like, that's
very
fantastic
don't
advice.
Don't get in a car accident.
I was thinking of just driving right off the road.
It's like, instead of giving me that kind of shit, why don't you tell me, like, give me tips on how to avoid stuff like that? Like, you know, don't just say, like, don't do this.
That's not what parents do.
Don't be careful. You might be careful, you know, and it's like,
be careful.
It's like, of course, I'm careful every goddamn day. Like,
yeah.
That's why I'm still here.
Yeah. Otherwise, I would have been totally reckless. I thought I was supposed to be reckless. I thought I was just supposed to break everything. So the crew of the Discovery, they know exactly what's on the line here. And, you know, Lieutenant Meany over there was just being unprofessional. And she was just basically trying to assert some kind of dominance, but then she does a total 180 flip when she sees the unprofessional
because
crew
she's Starfleet. Yeah. And we've seen, I mean, look, right? I don't justify the behavior. It's not a justification, but there's a reason for it, right? I would like to think if I were to encounter somebody from the year
2000.
Well, I was thinking more like the year 1000.
Yeah, well, I can't see.
And they're being all like friendly and they're speaking. I mean, that very old English, unintelligible English, saying things like, wait, whoa, what if I think?
Yeah.
And
bad English.
Yeah. Presuming they could speak English and they're hip enough to get around, you know, I could see people treating them like they were, you know, sort of obnoxious morons.
Yeah.
And that person. You know what? We don't even need that example. You know what is a better example? And it's only more upsetting because it's so fucked up. Is just a person who comes to a new country, does not speak the language, but they're smart. They are, you know, they have a perfectly good brain in their head, but they're in a new country and they don't know exactly how the metro works or the subway or how to buy a bus ticket, and they're treated like morons.
Yeah,
and it's like, you know, this person's a neuroscientist, but they don't understand the convoluted how do you get like the card to get charged up with money gag. Yeah. Right.
Everyone's dumb except people from here,
and that's what's happening here again. I don't justify it. I would like to think a better person wouldn't do that, and you know, the Admiral, as dickish as he is, he's treating them more like he's concerned that they could be a threat, not that they're stupid.
Yeah, I overall got a good vibe from him the whole time. Even for a second, he felt threatening, but yeah, he was.
And
he treated him with respect.
Yeah, Admiral Vance was played by Oded Fehr. He's one of those guys that's been in a ton of stuff. I think he's done a lot of video games or cartoons.
Oh yeah, that's what I read. Yeah,
but I mainly remember him from the 1999 version of The Mummy with Rachel Weisz and Brendan Fraser. He's one of the characters in that.
Jeez.
He's a very attractive man.
Yeah, he is. He's very well put together. He's got one of those
nice beard,
nice sexy beard and hair.
And his, as Jesse noted, his Confederate his Confederate soldier inspired admiral's outfit.
He's just a cat in a coat.
Yeah, pretty. Yeah, kind of. He's more attractive than Admiral Senatal.
He's kind of like Shahzad Latif's dad.
He is kind of. You know, he's kind of. You know, Shahzad Latif is another. Another guy who looks good in a beard.
Yeah.
Clem Fandango. Clem H. Fandango.
Clem H. Fandango.
So,
there's another actor named Clem Fandango. But you're not an actor.
So, Detmer had another, episode, I guess.
And he changed his name to Chris Bread.
Chris Bread.
No, yeah. Chris Bread.
Chris Bread. Beekeeper.
Stephen Toast.
Detmer had an episode again where she was like kind of freaking out.
She's still working on it.
She had to be reminded that it's okay, you can do this in time, just
because those future people scanned her and they were concerned by
they were also concerned by Burnham. There was Eli, who sounded like Ron Howard or something.
He was so obnoxious. He was so peppy and obnoxious.
Yeah. But Detmer had to be basically told, like, look, you got this down, just do what you normally do and chill out and you have plenty of time, you know. So, but yeah, that Eli guy, he was something else, you know.
Was that his name, Eli?
Yeah.
I wasn't exactly sure what they were
saying.
Sounded
like it said Eli. Yeah. Eli or Eli.
It was Eli. It was Eli. I don't know why would they call him Eli if it was Eli?
I was thinking maybe they were going for an EMH thing, except he wouldn't be the Eli, like maybe he's an emergency lie indicator.
I mean,
something. I don't know.
No, I mean, I get what you're saying. I just think like,
but you know, it's not
EMH.
Emergency.
EMH. There's no fun way to pronounce that. I mean, M. That's not
good.
That's not revealing.
Well, Picard, you had Emmett.
Like, there's no reason to say Eli. There's no reason to say Eli over Eli. You're adding an extra syllable for no reason. Eli versus Eli.
What about ELO?
That's what?
Electric
Light Orchestra.
Okay, what about it?
I'm just tossing out alternatives.
It kind of sucks.
Well, it's a person. It's a person you're referring to.
I think
to,
ELO so. Is like four people.
Well, no, I'm talking about Eli, motherfucker. God damn it. You did that on purpose.
Eli Whitney?
You did that on purpose.
Oh, Eli Whitney. That's a good one.
He's Eli. He's a person. He's an AI person. You call
Elijah
him Eli.
Wood. Elijah Wood.
Elijah Wood.
Now we're just saying things that sound like each other.
Frodo.
I'm Frodo. Right, you're wrong.
Bilbo. See, it's so much easier with Bilbo than with Frodo. Bilbo.
He's going to bounce that.
Bilbo Baggins. Bilbo.
Right, well, you know, that was a good consistent form of derailment for 5 minutes.
That was a good podcast.
Yeah.
Well, I was just saying, the past 5 minutes was just derailment.
We talked about the Admiral, the sexy Admiral.
Oh, you're getting back
the
on
sexy
track?
Admiral?
You're getting back on track?
No, well, I'm saying we talked
about... Let's derail it again.
We talked about the sexy... I don't know what else there is to talk about except for the sexy Admiral.
We're doing Dilly Dally.
To make sort of sly references to Toast of London.
We talked about...
To prove our comedy cred.
And just start...
Mystery melody.
Let's name all the things that sound like Eli. Elijah Wood.
Well, I enjoyed that. I thought that was fun.
Yeah, it's fine.
Elihu.
It's fine. It's fine. I'm not mad or anything. I'm not mad. Why?
Ellipse.
Why? Here's a question for you. Here's a real brain teaser. At the beginning, when they go onto the center, the light ship in the center of the engine
the thing generating the distortion field.
Yeah. Yeah, the thing generating the distortion field. When they went in there, and Saru and Adira and Burnham all left, Saru was like, Nielsen, you take the con.
Mm-hmm.
He gave it to Nielsen. Later on, when what's her name, Burnham left, when they were going on to the Tikoff, Burnham said,
Reese got the con.
Reese got the con.
Reese
got the con.
In both scenes, Reese and Nielsen were present on the bridge in both scenes. So why did...
They just take turns.
Yeah, take it in turns.
You're not supposed to take turns, I thought. I thought you're supposed
to... No, if you are...
Anybody can be the con.
You're supposed to be next in command.
No. That is true for a couple people, but then for the other people, if you want to...
Wait, that sounds really arbitrary. For some people, but not others.
No, what I mean specifically is there's the main chain, you know, the captain, first in command, second in command. there's a few people up there where there's a direct order. But then there's also the remaining bridge officers, all of whom desire and all of whom would benefit from repeated exposure to taking command of the bridge in order to have the experience of doing that, because you want to cultivate the people who work under you.
When the Cylons took over and killed a bunch of people, that chain of command went all the way down to what's her name?
That was different. That is for a political office, right? A political office. As opposed to
fine,
this is just sort of like the standard, like featured on duty deck officer.
You would do this in a job atmosphere as well. You would want people to take turns, ideally, so that everyone's got a little bit of flavor. You can see what's going on there. You'd be like, oh, Nilsson did a good job. Yeah. Oh, Reese is doing a good job too.
Okay,
maybe,
I'll buy that.
Or to be fair to you.
To me.
To you. Burnham might have something against Nilsson.
Yeah.
Burnham might have something against Reese.
Yeah.
And wants to put him in a position to fail.
Yeah.
Where he's not ready. I think that's unlikely. I think she's probably being a really great commander.
It's a good answer. Also, they were mentioning about like how the chief transporter officer had to be on duty and like had to be ready to go. And I was wondering, who's the chief transporter officer? Is it Owashikan or Owashikan?
I don't know. We'll find out.
Because it's I don't think we will find out.
Maybe it'll be an ancestor of O'Brien.
Sort of tactical.
Well, because she's it seemed like
chief petty officer. Charles O'Brien. It wouldn't be Charles.
It seemed like
that's offensive.
It seemed like Burnham said, "Hey, chief transport officer, keep on your toes." And then it seemed like Owashikan responded to that. I'm just making like dumb connections.
No, and this is a minor thing. I heard it differently. I heard her not saying it to the transportation officer. I heard her saying to inform the transportation.
That's another good answer.
But you did make me think, which I didn't at the time, about will we meet this person? Is this a character we should care about? Is it what was that Captain Who's in Captain Picard that we never got to meet? Captain Riggleman,
Rigglesworth,
Captain Robards,
who lived on the planet. When they were on the planet with
on
Riker,
on Nepenthe,
they were
And Riker's daughter was all hanging out with Captain Roberts.
Sounds
Captain
shady.
Captain Rascal.
Captain Rascal.
Captain Randall. Crandall. Captain Crandall.
Crandall.
What? I think it started with an R. Captain Crandall.
Well, it kind of sounds like an R.
Well, we got there in the end.
Yeah.
Team effort.
It was a long journey.
It was.
Because Randall's a more common name than Crandall.
Crandall, I would argue, is not a name at all.
I was thinking about naming my cat Crandall. Not my two cats I have now, because they already had names, but I was thinking about it.
You
can
just
cat
rename
name.
Them. They don't care.
Yeah, it's, you know, it just didn't feel right at that time. I know you can. I might have in a different situation, maybe, but...
I might have in a different situation, but... Not with these cats. Not with these cats at all.
Transporter room 3.
Miles Edward O'Brien. We understand.
We lost all of our Irish listeners.
We can't do Irish accents. No American can, actually. We can only do the Lucky Charms version of it, which amuses us. We respect that it could be in some circles considered offensive. Before we wrap things up, I wanted to touch base real quick to see if there was anything key that we missed. Because we jumped around a little bit this episode, but, you know, I think we got through all the key plot points. We mentioned Georgiou and her weird interaction with David Cronenberg, and especially at the end of the episode that we don't know exactly what's going on with her. We talked about Nan deciding to stay behind. I will add that got me teared up. I teared up again a couple times this episode. This whole season, Discovery has found at least one point during an episode to make me get all weepy. And with Nan, it was particularly interesting for me because her whole deal is being security officer, tough, you know, aggressive. But her whole argument was based on love and affection and emotion. That her justification for her, you know what I'm saying? And I thought that was really a great juxtaposition from her normal personality. It wasn't that she was acting different. She was revealing an additional part of herself that she had previously hid away until she had witnessed the people, the family and the situation, you know, the Barzan people.
And she really kind of like it spoke highly of Barzan because, like she said, you know, the first mission is a success, mm-hmm. you know, because she came in there and joined. I will say, though, that Saru, I know this wasn't his intention, but it seemed like he kind of tried to exploit that a little bit, because when Admiral Vance was talking to him afterwards about, like, oh, you managed to make sure everything was okay with that situation. And Saru was like, we're always prepared to deal with every kind of situation, you know, blah, blah, blah. Sort of implying that, like, oh, we knew she'd do it all along or something. But they didn't know that she was going to do that. If she hadn't, like, gone behind, they would have just taken that dude off the ship. So I guess...
From the Admiral's perspective, yeah, I guess probably, mission accomplished.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's true. So I guess in the end...
But yeah, it would be funny if it turns out that, like, you know, in season 5, we find out Saru is just a piece of shit racist.
Yeah.
He's just like, yeah, keep a few of them around. You know, we can toss them around. We can take advantage of them. I want a couple of Andorians. Gonna be a couple of Cardassians. You got any of them Q lying around?
He's got them all hidden in a basement.
Spoonies.
In Lorca's, you know, cage... Cages and other stuff.
Yeah, it was an interesting. It was interesting to have her sort of like. I was out of nowhere, seeming. Yeah, she decided to stay behind there, and.
But at the same time, also felt appropriate.
Yeah, because she brought up Arium, and after Arium, that kind of changed her. You know, the Arium situation from last season,
and the whole jumping 2,000 years into the future, yeah, and then seeing a family and reminding her of her family.
Right. Yeah. So yeah,
it's really freaking everybody out, that whole time travel shit.
Well, I also, you know. Some people were saying, like, oh, they just made her a regular character in the credits and now they're getting rid of her. I don't think they're getting rid of her. I fully expect we'll see her again probably this season.
They'll come back and pick her up.
Would be my guess. We'll see. Maybe it's just laying some groundwork for something in the future. But they telegraphed very clearly, I think, that, you know, this wasn't the last we'd see of Commander Nod.
When they beamed off the Tikoff, Colbert goes, you know, one to beam back, you know, and they know to beam him back. And then someone else says one. And that kind of reminded me of kind of like, why do they say, like, if there's 5 of them, why would they say 3 to beam back? How does it know which 3 to beam back? And if it already knows which 3 to beam back, why are they bothering to say 3 to beam back? You know what I'm saying?
I believe it's for the same reason that in TV shows, nobody ever says goodbye before they hang up the phone.
Yeah, fuck that shit.
I saw some YouTube thing once where somebody said, here, we're going to do some scenes where we actually say goodbye on the phone and you're going to see that it feels weird on TV. But I don't know if it feels weird. And it did. When you watch people actually conclude a conversation like a human being, it was strange. But I don't know if it was strange because of some fundamental thing about narrative and TV logic where it just seems obtrusive and disrupts the flow, which was the argument of the video, or if we are so enculturated by filmic language that that we just, it looks weird and it feels weird when that happens.
Wow. That's weird. That's fucked up to think about.
It is.
Anyway, Star Trek has its own versions of that, and I think the beaming thing is one of them. Also, that the computer knows when you're saying computer, like, to when you want to talk to it versus when you're just commenting on a computer.
Right.
Like, the when Geordi would be like, well, I ran a level 5 diagnostic on the computer and everything is fine. You do that here with fucking Google, man. Google or Alexa, they won't fucking leave you alone. The worst is when you're watching TV and the Google thinks that it heard something about Google from the TV, so it reduces the TV volume and is like, yo, it's Google, what do you want? And then I'm like, Google, you're talking to the TV. You're effectively talking to yourself. This is ridiculous.
Or it's like, isn't it about time to run another level 5 diagnostic? It's like, no, Google, I already did that.
Yeah, we don't need to be running all these diagnostics.
Maybe,
probably
a 3 or a 2.
I think that the computers like the diagnostics. It's kind of like getting a good scrub down.
Man.
You know, you get a sponge bath at the hospital when you're really sick.
I've never had a sponge bath.
Me neither.
As far as I know, they don't exist.
I imagine it's pretty nice. Anyway, computers are like that, especially in Star Trek.
Foreshadowing, when Saru was talking to Burnham at the end, he's like, you know, you're great. I really value your opinion, but don't get me into some shit. Cause like, he literally,
do you think that was foreshadowing?
Well, maybe not, but foreshadowing, maybe not necessarily that he's going to get into shit. Although when he stayed behind, he was literally going to in trouble for that because, you know, the Admiral was saying, like, get the fuck back here.
We're going to,
this guy is curtains for him.
Saru, what's wrong with
Michael Burnham's going to get into some shit.
Yeah,
she's going to fuck some shit up.
So, yeah, so it was, it was putting him in danger. I think it might be foreshadowing that she might clash with the Admiral in the future.
I hope it could be. Yeah. I hadn't thought of that, but I hope, because what I took it as partly an example of Saru being in command and demonstrating that.
Yeah.
Not being shy about it. You know, not you could understand how that could be awkward, especially when you have such a close relationship with somebody. It might be awkward to kind of dress them down a little bit, especially after everything just went kind of awesome and they did a good job. But I don't know. I also took it as a learning experience for Michael. You know, he was reminding her, saying like, dude, Michael, we've gone through this shit before. Yeah. And this example showed that by and large, you know, this Saru's way did work out in the end. He did need a little bit of that pushing from Michael. It's not like she did nothing in terms of arguing with the Admiral. But
He brought up a separate point along the same subject. It was a separate point in the episode when he was talking about when she was like, let's steal the information of where the Keeley stuff is. She was talking about she
wanted to get her hands on it.
Yeah, and he was like, you want to pilfer their shit?
I like how he let her say her whole spiel and then went back and he's like, get our hands on it.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
It's like his brain stopped there. He was like, whatever the fuck else you're saying, you're already on the wrong fucking path, lady.
Yeah. And he goes, our first Federation act will not be to pilfer its property and violate a direct order. Then he goes, that is a lesson I thought you would have learned by now. Mm-hmm. And that's like, ouch. That's like fucked her up from the beginning. Yeah. And that was a dressing down right there.
Well, we'll see how it goes. I also think it's worth mentioning another great example of Saru sort of channeling Michael, but channeling and redirecting sort of the motivation from Michael into nicer, more diplomatic language when he gave the whole analogy about the Renaissance painting developing perspective with the Admiral. Saru, I think he's getting really good at starting to figure out. He's like, all right, what's going to work on this guy? Being a dick to him doesn't seem to be working, so I'm going to kind of stroke his intelligence bone.
And when you're a dick to someone like that, it tends to put one when
it it's backfires.
When one is actively being a dick to another person, the one being a dick tends to turn off the listening skills. Mm-hmm. And so while he's doing that, he does a double duty where he's, you know, like you said, massaging their happy bones. And at the same time, he's allowing himself to listen to what they have to say, which helps in the future.
The other thing was that just we already talked about how this whole plot is a very classic Star Trek style plot. But at the end, you know, the Keeley are not only saved, but they're saved by seeds, and they're saved by seeds that are saved in a seed bank.
Yeah,
you know, and so the idea that the seeds were helpful, but for a reason not perceived by the people who put them there.
Perceived.
And that, I think, is a very, maybe not super overt, but it's clearly a sort of global climate change, you know, metaphor in the sense, you know, you prepare and the benefits could be even beyond what you think they are, right? And it's just a mechanism, you know, another example of that type of thing.
I guess last couple of things I had to say, it was just mentioned that there's a Terran holy day is when they murdered a bunch of Vulcans. That's a holy day.
That was like their first contact.
April 5th, 2063.
Yeah. Yeah, that's when it was. So that's kind of, that was humorous. She's like, it's a minor one. Oh yeah, Saru had the last Kelpian, his last Kelpian with biochemical traces of Vahari. Mm-hmm. All right, okay. Are you prone to emotional exaggeration? That's a fucked up thing to say to someone too.
It is.
And then I guess the last thing I wanted to say is something that I completely can't remember now. So
coronal mass erection.
That probably,
mass ejaculation.
Thank you for reminding me. What I wanted to note was that Saru kind of looked like he had uncircumcised penis fingers.
Wow!
There's a scene where you see a close up. You see at it's near the beginning of the episode. I believe it's near the beginning where there's a close up of his hands, and they look like uncircumcised penis fingers.
Why are you uncomfortable saying uncircumcised?
I'm just saying. It's just, there's nothing wrong with uncircumcised. It's just when they're your fingers.
But when he points at you, oh man.
But yeah.
It's a floppy, it's a bunch of floppy little.
Yeah.
So I will have to double check on that.
So that was funny.
I thought he had some claw action.
Foreskin fingers.
So your mass erection comment actually helped me. That's the
all right. I'm glad I helped you. And hopefully we helped our audience this week as we discussed in a somewhat haphazard fashion, but a fun one, I hope.
That's what you say every week.
Episode 51. It was sure a lot of fun.
It was. It was a lot of fun.
There's no reason to go in order down the.
I'm not saying we gotta go in order. I'm delighted, bro. I'm delighted. I'm delighted. Don't worry about me, bro. Like and subscribe and rate and review, and then you can do the YouTubes. We got a YouTube channel. We got feedback at itsgotstartrek.com.
I like this episode. This was a good episode.
Yeah.
This was a really good episode.
Of the show.
Yeah. The season has been super solid.
It's been moving along, man.
It's been moving along. And as it goes along, it kind of is crystallizing. But also, I don't know exactly what's going to happen next. Adira, we don't know exactly what happened to Adira.
Yeah.
We just know that Adira was sent to get analyzed. So
She was back on the ship like when they went to the Tikoff, wasn't she?
I can't recall.
I can't even remember either.
I don't know. Yeah. I think they'll be back, though.
Yeah.
They will be back. So
be a big part of it.
I'm definitely looking forward to next week. We don't normally talk about the previews for next week, and I'm not going to go out of my way to, other than to say we see evidence that in the future they have the Running Man style electric fences where when you run through them, your head explodes.
Oh, nice. I'm into that.
Which looked awesome and gross. So next week's episode looks fucking bananas off the wall. So I'm excited about it.
Bananas off the wall.
There'll be a link somewhere on our website.
Balls to the wall.
To see the preview for next week's episode. So you'll be all set. So anyway, yeah. Feedback at itsgotstartrek.com. Website at itsgotstartrek.com. Subscribe to the podcast on every single fucking podcast player that's out there.
Just do it all.
Yeah, subscribe up just a bunch of times. YouTube, you know, It's Got Star Trek. Just search for these things. Facebook, Twitter, at It's Got Star Trek.
It's got it. It's got Star Trek.
We got it all over the fucking place. So, you know, do all that. Contact us if you like. Anyway.
Send us a message, you son of a bitch.
So that'll do it for us this evening, and we will pass it along to next evening. If you're hearing this on Saturday night, you're going to have to wait another week.
Aww.
That's just the way it is. You're going to have to wait another week. I mean, you're going to have to wait till Thursday anyway to get the episode. And then we got to fucking watch the episodes and record this shit. So you got to wait another week if you listen to this on Saturday. If you're listening to this at some indeterminate time in the future, you can cruise right into the next episode. No problem. Autoplay, or if you got to go into your podcast player and like click on it. Whatever you got to do, you can listen to the next one.
The next one's one of our best episodes.
The next one is, yeah. We can determine
it came, that. It came out really well.
Yeah, using math.
You're confusing
me. Using math. Derivatives.
It's bullshit. You can travel forward in time and be a criminal, because that's the fucked up thing about a temporal war is they can decide to make it illegal to travel through time after you traveled through time. Like, that's fucked up.
It's entrapment.
Yeah. Well, there's a bunch of laws like that on the books today.
Yeah, that's right.
But speaking of, I was just thinking of that because you're talking about how we somehow know our next episode is awesome already.
Yeah, it's magic. All right.
Oh, Asira. We're going to, at some point, he was talking about Asira's been becoming more brazen by the day. The Admiral said that.
Good call. Yeah.
The Kuyoga is reporting the Air India, the Emerald Chain thing. Anyway,
yeah, so. Lore, world building, and we'll learn more about it next week. Next Saturday.
Boy, voice.
Saru is so swishy.
So good night, and we will talk to you in the near future. A week from now. 1 week.
So you were dead?
Yes. As I said.
Clinically dead?
Well, I was emotionally dead, too. And I was murdered. I can really do a number on you. But my murderer and I are good now.